Good morning. How's it going? Okay, all right. My name is Kristen Butler. I'm the Director of Public Programs here at Historic London Town and Gardens, and I'm thrilled to welcome all of you here for our second lecture for this year's winter lecture series. Sounds like the rain's going to start a little later in the day, so if you're able to go out into the gardens before you leave after the lecture series, you're very welcome to, and I really encourage you to do so. The gardens are beautiful at any time of year. And if you need more information about the gardens, just stop at the front desk and we can tell you a little bit more. I wanted to tell you about our upcoming lectures. Next week, we have Paul Lovelace, Director of Agriculture at the Epikeet Foundation's National Colonial Farm. And he will be presenting Something to Depend On, Tobacco Culture in the 18th Century. And then on February 24th, we have Kenneth Cohen, PhD, and Curator of American Culture at the Smithsonian's National History Museum. National Museum of American History. And he will be presenting Gaming the Law, Gambling Despite Laws Against It in Early America. So both of those should be fun. On March 3rd, to follow up our lecture series, we have our Partying Through Time workshop, where archaeologists from the Lost Town Projects will pull together real artifacts from their collection of Anne Arundel County artifacts. And they'll be presenting a hands-on, family-friendly workshop. You get to listen to experts describe festivities through the centuries, then go on a guided exploration of artifacts from ancient Native American feasts, colonial taverns, and other historic celebrations. Online registration is now available, or you can sign up by stopping by the front desk. On April 6th, we'll have a cider talk and tasting. Millstone Cellars Cidery, which is a local cidery, will provide samples of their ciders, which we're also going to enjoy in colonial cocktails, while Rod Cofield, our executive director, discusses cider making in the colonial era. Online registration for that one will be up very, very soon. April 6th through the 8th is Maryland Day weekend. Admission, as always, is free for members, but there's also a reduced $1 admission for non-members all weekend. We'll also have costume interpreters and special activities for kids on Saturday and Sunday. Then April 20th and 21st is our annual spring plant sale, which returns featuring native annuals and perennials, including plants found in London Town's horticultural collections. At the very end of April, we have a very busy April. April 28th is the Maryland House and Garden Pilgrimage's annual, Anne Arundel County tour. You can explore 9 beautiful houses, gardens, and sites in this self-driving tour through Anne Arundel County as part of the Maryland House and Garden Pilgrimage. Tour buses are also welcome. Proceeds from the Anne Arundel County tour will go to support efforts here at London Town to enhance the garden entrance. And tickets are available online or by stopping at the front desk. For those of you who aren't members, if you join, you get free or reduced prices on these programs, as well as admission to the museum, while supporting all of the wonderful things that we do. And if you sign up today, we'll take the cost of your ticket that you spent today off of your membership fee. Finally, it's time to introduce Steve. Steve Lennick will be presenting The Addictive Pleasures of Sugar in the Colonial Mid-Atlantic. Dr. Lennick is a historical archaeologist of the African diaspora who has done fieldwork at plantations, missions, and military installations throughout the Caribbean and Mid-Atlantic. In 2010, he completed a PhD in anthropology at Syracuse University with a dissertation focused on a French Jesuit mission in Dominica. This began research he is now continuing with a study of Jesuit manors in Southern Maryland. Among his publications are articles in the Journal of Social Archaeology, Ethnohistory, the International Journal of American Historical Archaeology, and Historical Archaeology. And he is co-editor of the 2017 Rutledge volume, Material Cultures of Slavery and Abolition in the British Caribbean. Please join me in welcoming Steve Lennick.
All right, good morning, everybody. Thank you for coming out this morning. Pleasure to be able to contribute to this winter lecture series. This is a topic that I've been thinking about for some time. So my background, as Kristen introduced, is as a historical archaeologist of plantations. So for my first fieldwork experiences years ago in the U.S. Virgin Islands, I'm familiar with sugar and what entailed the production and manufacture of it based on slave labor and plantations. I've since gone to other places in Jamaica and Dominica for my own research. I've also been, I mean, this will be now the fourth time this current semester at St. Mary's, I'm teaching a class called Anthropology of Drinking, Smoking, and Vice. So one of the topics that I included is sugar and caffeine, along with you know, rum and cocaine and amphetamine and other types of drugs and things that humans consume. So this is a topic that I, of course, have been thinking about here for some time. And so what I'm going to do today is talk about the role of sugar, specifically sugarcane, and how this has become a taste, a flavor that, an ingredient that has infiltrated so many of our foods and beverages. Sugar is, whether you realize it or not, and maybe some of you do if you have a dietary concern, it's everywhere. It's all over the place. It's an addictive pleasure, but it's been cultivated over the centuries. It wasn't always this way with sugar in all of our foods that we eat. So I'm going to trace some of the history of that with a focus on the Maryland and Mid-Atlantic, of course. But this does require that we kind of expand the scope a little bit. So, you know, to understand sugar consumption in Maryland and the Mid-Atlantic, you do have to think more broadly at that Atlantic scale. Where is the sugar being produced? Who is manufacturing it? Of course, that's mostly enslaved African labor. And how the production, exchange, and consumption of it all fit together. So,
pull it toward you.
Okay, so one of the qualities of sugar is that it's in so many foods and drinks that we have. And there are many lists like this that you can find online, but all the different names that sugar kind of hides and obscures itself as ingredients in different foods that we have. So, you know, I think it's on this list, but my favorite, my third is like evaporated cane syrup. That's sugar. It's called cane syrup. That sounds healthy. Anything from concentrate. Some of you may know like the high fructose corn syrup from corn, of course. But it just, it's everywhere. This week I had some barbecue sauce. The first ingredient is high fructose corn syrup. I challenge you guys to go into the, like, go in the gas station. I want to get a drink when I'm on the road. If you don't get water, which has no sugar, hopefully, because there are like vitamin waters, so those have sugar, Gatorade has sugar. It's in everything. It's so difficult to escape sugar. But it's not an essential thing. We don't need it, but we need it. You know, it's essential for desserts, ice cream, jam, so many different. So how did this happen? I also would question at this point whether it is an addiction, and there's some criticisms. Many people look to the disease model of addiction, and it doesn't really quite work out for sugar. There's craving for it, but often it's mixed with things that are different, like caffeine, for example, like sodas and sugars. But today, and this is, there's other versions of this that you guys can find. This is from the Washington Post. This is the, there's the U.S. right up there, 120 grams of sugar. We're way above the World Health Organization recommended intake. So where did this come from? How did this happen? This sweetness, this flavor that has come to infiltrate so many of our foods and drinks. Now, when I, also some of my early studies, I came across a book by Sidney Mintz, and I'm going to be talking about a lot of his work here today. So a book called Sweetness and Power. He's an anthropologist. He passed away a couple years ago, professor at Johns Hopkins University for a long time. In his work, and that's what I'll be referring to here today, looks at how and why this desire for this taste of sweetness was cultivated over time. It's something that's culturally constructed. It's grown up over the century. Sugar, especially cane sugar, started as something that really only the elite, the wealthy, had access to. But now it's become And again, unless you have some type of a dietary restriction, it's an essential part of all of your kitchen, your pantry. It's out there by the coffee. I mean, drive down the road and sugar is in every house and every store, all the food. It's in so many places. Mince is focused by looking at the taste of it and how it connects people at an Atlantic scale. So it's consumers in Maryland and England and France and other places that rely on the brutality of the enslaved labor system in the Caribbean, Brazil, elsewhere, in parts of the United States. The slave trade, all of that wealth and everything that went with that, and all the suffering as well, to produce this taste, this flavor. Thinking back to when Europeans first arrived in Maryland, this is before we had cane sugar in everything as a necessity for people's diets. What were the sources of sweetness that were available? And just to briefly go through this, of course, we have the fructose that appears in ripe fruit, the persimmon and the cherry and the peach and the things. There is a sweetness attached to this, of course. Many of you probably eat these as well. Probably if you had some of these foods today, in recipes, often sugar is added to increase the sweetness. There are ways you can preserve fruits. You can extract syrups and other things. But is it purely sweet? And do you have a cup of sugar made from peaches that you add to a recipe? No, it doesn't really work that way. But we can get sweetness from fruit, of course. In the Americas, we also have the maple tree, and I'm familiar with this more from Connecticut and New England, where I grew up. Are these around in this part of Maryland? Most of these would be in Western Maryland, I would think. But this would be another source of sweetness that Europeans learned from Native Americans. So you set up the whatever receptacle to collect the sap, you boil that down and produce the maple syrup. I have some of that here as an example. This, of course, is affected by seasonality. If it's a cold or a dry or a wet summer, it takes time for the trees to grow. But you can make the syrup and make granular sugar from that as well. And there are people that are concerned with thrift and self-sufficiency. You also can get sweetness from the beans of the bean pods of the honey locust. This is one I just learned about recently looking into this paper. This one I don't know too much about, but it's a naturally available source of sweetness. You'll also have corn, of course, and before the days of high fructose corn syrup, which you guys may see in many different foods, we have people were realizing, Native Americans and then early colonists, that you could extract the sweetest flavor, from the crushing the stalk, you get the juice from corn for flavor. And then the other naturally available resource would be honey. Now, my understanding, according to a 1983 book prior I was looking at, is that Native Americans did not have honey bees. They did not have, or at least in this part of the country, words for honey or beeswax. It was a European honeybee that was brought in. If I understand correctly, this was known as the Englishman's fly to some indigenous peoples here. And you have beekeeping on many properties. There's a source that says in Prince George County inventory of estates, three estates had beehives between 1696 and 1720. But this really took off by the end of the 18th century. Beehives on their property. There are also many wild sources of honey as well. There's this practice called lining, where I guess bees fly in a straight line. They go to the pollen or whatever it is, and back to their hive. And people would line up and figure out what the straight line was, and follow the bees back to the nest, and get all the honey that way. So that's fun. Each has its own flavor. There's limitations here in terms of storage and shipments. How to produce them at a large scale, but of course these factor into recipes here in Maryland. But how do you produce sugar and sweetness at a large scale? How do you sell at a profit and trade and exchange it? And the answer there, of course, is sugar cane. So there's a long history of sugar cane. I'm not going to get into too many details here. This is growing beside the road here, the Appleton Rum Distillery in Jamaica, that I visited a few years ago. It was a type. It's a type of grass. It was first domesticated in New Guinea. It really grows best. It has a lot of heat and water. It grows best in tropical environments. It gradually moved westward over time. So sometimes during the period of the Roman Empire, the Romans knew about it. Really, with the spread of Islam around 700 or so, it really came close to the Mediterranean region. During the Crusades, some Europeans were actually producing their own sugar for themselves. But really, it was a sugar cane. Sugar from that was for the elite. The wealthy, privileged could afford to purchase it. There's some great examples. Mintz has a lot of these sweetness and power book where they'll be like sculptured out of sugar. It would be like a house with a bunch of people and stuff like that. Things actually made out of sugar that then you would consume. It was used as a medicine. Spice, a decorative material, like I mentioned, a sweetener, a preservative, and you know, as you go out into the Atlantic islands, it was grown in the Madeira, Sao Tome, the Canaries, other places like this by the Spanish and the Portuguese. But it's really going over to the Caribbean, where mass production at an industrial scale really began to take off. It's first brought over to Hispaniola on the second voyage of Columbus. Planted in mid-January 1494. They built the first cane processing plant in Hispaniola in the Caribbean in 1503. But the product wasn't quite there yet. Soon it would take off. Now, to manufacture sugar from the cane, you can see the stalks here. It is quite a labor-intensive process. Once you cut the cane, this takes, in some cases, over a year to grow. You see the long canes there. You have to, within 24 hours or less, move this to a production facility to extract the juice. So that takes amassing a lot of labor in one location to cut the cane by hand, to remove all the leaves, to transport the cane to a factory. And you know what's became the answer for this? Of course, there were some indentured laborers early on in the Caribbean, Brazil, other places, but rapidly became enslaved African laborers that were the ones responsible, that were, of course, forced to produce sugar. And all of that entailed the brutalities of the Middle Passage and the dehumanization of enslavement. In the Caribbean, it was in fact cheaper to buy new laborers to work in the cane fields than it was to actually care for their upkeep, providing food, shelter, and so on. So really, here's this kind of picturesque view, and I'll show more of that. But it really masks a lot of unpleasant things. So there we go. So here's what the cane looks like a little more close up here. You can try this. Sometimes you can find it canned, or maybe Whole Foods would probably charge you a lot of money for it. But I've had this in the field where you go get your machete or a knife, you cut a piece, you scrape off this skin, and you just kind of chew the cane and the juice, and it's really bad for your teeth, but it's really good. So the sugar cane, of course, is very tasty, and this did become it's a good flavor, and we learned to crave it as humans here. And so Mintz, City Mintz, who I mentioned earlier, he talks about per capita annual consumption of sugar in 1700 to 1709 was 4 pounds per person in England. A century later, it was 18 pounds per person. And continue to grow from there. It's a little bit slower in the Chesapeake as there were more local choices, but like everywhere else, it expanded very rapidly. So to understand, as the point that I'm making here, how it operates in Maryland, you have to see how it was produced and shipped and how these different regions in the Atlantic Basin were connected to each other. So how did you actually produce the white granular sugar that you see today? Here's a view of enslaved laborers working in Antigua, and this just looks, they're hoeing to plant the cane. Certainly this is a enslaved labor system. You can see the large number of laborers and a ganging system that was required. So you have the first gang that would do the hoeing, another one would come in and plant. They would similarly be used to then collect the cane and process it during the season. So it looks peaceful, but it's not really. Mintz and others have referred to this as the as a factory in the field. So you guys may be familiar with mass production at a factory setting, you know, like a textile mill in you know, England or the U.S. or somewhere. But really, this as people argue, this is the first place in which mass production, or what we might call industrial time consciousness, took place in terms of the most efficient organization of labor and capital, and being aware of the wealth that was attached to the field, to the volume of cane that you would produce, and then the wealth that would circulate based on this. Here's another view of a plantation in which here are the laborers that are cutting the nice cane fields, and you know, all of this to support this transatlantic market. And this was everywhere, essentially. There's a British, many British and French and European ports were supported by wealth generated by sugar and its sale. There's a book talking about the picturesque rural British manor house out there in the countryside, and all of the English imagery that entails. This would be the case for the U.S. as well. But those manor houses, supported by wealth generated from sugar and enslaved labor. So even though they're far away, these plantations and the sale of the sugar and the molasses and so on was supporting this lifestyle. So very briefly, how do you actually produce the cane once you cut it? So here's an animal mill. You see the cows walking in a circle to turn the rollers. You would have your laborers bring in all of your cane. You would pass it through one side of the rollers and then pass it through another side. The juice would drip out, and you would send that to a processing facility. I'll get to that in a minute. So all the juice is going down like a sluice type of thing to get to your factory. So animals could turn the mill for you. That's one possibility. Windmills could do it. There are certain places in the Caribbean and elsewhere in the Americas where the wind is really good. This is in St. Croix in the Virgin Islands. That you see the windmill there, but the device on the left, you can kind of rotate it and turn it to catch the wind, and you're going to have your same wheels there right inside. Again, you would pass the cane through, pass it out again. This would go on all night, the work of extracting the juice. Apparently they would keep a machete or an axe nearby in case somebody's arm got caught. They would just have to, you know, cut off the arm right there. So it's, you know, it's not a it's a sweet product, but not a pleasant history of it. And many of these are still standing today. You also have I have pictures of these that are kind of falling apart here today, but you have a big water aqueduct there with a lot of capital invested in shipping the water. This is another one in Jamaica. So the water would come in, and that would turn the wheels that would grind the cane. So this requires the centralization of production, of housing, of the fields, that same industrial modern type of setting. And then later on, of course, we have a steam power mill. So this is an example in Cuba. A lot of machinery was produced in the United States or Europe and brought over. So large expanses of acreage devoted to growing cane with a centralized factory. Some places had trains set up, railways to actually move the cane more quickly. This developed in, say, Puerto Rico, Cuba, some of the Spanish islands in the 19th century. Where I've done some research at State Bethlehem and St. Croix in the U.S. Virgin Islands, purchased in 1917, the U.S. government for a period of time actually ran one of those central factories, like the one at Bethlehem, as they wanted to increase efficiency. And all right, so that's some of the ways of getting the juice. Once you have the juice, this is a repurposed copper sugar boiler. You see these things kind of in people's houses and out there now. The juice would be squeezed, a fire would be underneath this thing. And it would boil the cook the sugar, right? That would get out any impurities. You kind of skim that stuff off the top. Eventually, you're thickening it, so you move it to be a row of these, the kind of Jamaica train type of setup, where you, at a certain consistency, you would move it to the next one. The fire would be continuing, kind of boiling it down. I've seen this, and this is the what you would see in the 17th, 18th century, but I've been to rum, where they make rum. There's enormous vats, like huge vats of sugar that they're, of the syrup that they're cooking down. And knowledge of how to do this, when the sugar was ready to be moved to the next one, how to keep the temperature right, was a very valuable knowledge. The boiler, often a slave, would be, you know, very highly skilled to know when the consistency, rubbing the syrup, and know when to move it through. So you boil down that, thicken that syrup up. This is like you would do with maple sugar and other things as well. And eventually, once you have that thick syrup, you would pour it into these. This is a picture in a museum that I flipped upside down. This is a sugar mold. So this would be the real thick syrup would be put in the top. The what would be the molasses would drip out the bottom into one of these. So you'd have this cone, the sugar mold, set up on top of that drip jar. The drip jar would collect what is essentially molasses. This would be the sugar mold. Sometimes they would put clay on top of it to kind of seal it, and you have your muscovado sugar, which was the darker stuff, and then you have your clayed sugar that was closer to the top. And there would be molasses in it, and there would be Britain, France, other places that would be the ones that would make the actual refined sugar. So it would be shipped out of the Caribbean. It would be, I have this, this kind of, if you've seen like the sugar in the raw, if you have your coffee, or this, sometimes it's called turbinado, but muscovado is the term you usually see. This still has some of the molasses in it. It's not fully processed into that nice, pure white sugar that all of you would be probably familiar with, right? So that process, this is like what the Domino Sugar Factory, it used to be in Brooklyn, or in Baltimore now, would further process it and remove all of the molasses to get that nice white granular sugar. So this would be shipped to the British colonies or the United States, or then to Europe. And this one right here, this drip jar that would collect the molasses, the sugar going through there and dripping out the cone, were made in locally in the Caribbean, like the French would do this in Guadeloupe and Marie-Galante. But also in Alexandria, Virginia, and in Baltimore as well. There was a refineries in Alexandria that produced 800,000 pounds of sugar according to 1810 census. There was this tool and chuck factory in Baltimore in the early 19th century that produced these sugar jars and sugar molds and shipped them down to the Caribbean. So some of you may have heard of that, the triangular trade theory of how the economy worked, where it's like obviously the triangle goes from Europe to Africa to the Americas, but really we think in terms of an Atlantic scale now, the circulation at least economically, culturally, of moving all around the different countries and cultures surrounding the Atlantic basin. So these would be produced in Maryland, Virginia, and shipped to the Caribbean, and then filled up from there, and they come back with a sugar loaf inside. And then later on would be refined in the United States as well. All right, this making sense, everybody? This is just a brief overview of the process of where sugar actually comes from. One thing that you'll notice with this, and I always do this when I go into the grocery store, if you look at the Domino sugar that I got at the Safeway or wherever, where does this sugar actually come from, right? All I see, Domino, that's the Baltimore factory, and I'll see distributed by Domino Foods Yonkers, New York. But where did the actual sugar cane, where was did it come from? Who grew it? Where does that come from? There's no indication of that. And I've always done this. You go to the sugar part of the aisle, you go in the Safeway, the food line, or wherever, and the site of production, the laborers, their role is essentially removed from sugar as a commodity. So a lot of this background that I'm talking about here is kind of erased from the understanding of sugar and where it comes from. So what did this sugar enable? As I talked about, it's produced a lot of wealth that was able to support the transatlantic economy. And it also was part of what fueled the Industrial Revolution. solutions. So you can find, this is an image from England, and you can find a similar factory style scenes in the United States as well. Sugar was part of what fueled the Industrial Revolution, right? You have your laborers working long hours. They need to stay awake. This is, before we had any workers' rights and OSHA regulations and so on. And how did you keep a stable, alert laborer? And this is going back to Vince again. You have these crops that are proletarian hunger killers, you would refer to it as, right? So if you guys have ever taken what do you do on your break from work, right? You got a cup of coffee, you put some sugar in there, you drink your tea, you have your chocolate bar, that's got a lot of sugar in there. Tobacco, maybe you smoke your cigarette on your break, right? All of those products there are non-essential foodstuffs. Sugar is empty calories. You process that really quickly. But if you're fatigued, if you're tired, if you have many hours to work in your factory setting, this is what gets you going, right? So that kind of what you can say. If you're driving on the road, you get a coffee, put some sugar in there, get a chocolate bar. That's removing the pangs of hunger and kind of livening you up again and going back. So we're not laborers at this scale, but this again, these non-essential goods that were addictive pleasures essentially were what was able to support all of this this taste of sugar in the economy that it produced. All right, so how does this play out in Maryland, of course, as our site here today? This has been educational for me preparing for this talk. I hadn't really looked at this too closely for Maryland, so I have learned a lot about this topic here today. Now, there were some attempts to actually grow sugarcane in Maryland. As the sugarcane took off, that was where the money really was. There were attempts to find places where you could grow it for less and spend less on labor and shipping and so on. So the Caribbean and the Brazil and Florida, Louisiana kind of declined. Other Africa, other places would, or China or somewhere would grow sugarcane as well. There was an attempt in the 1850s by, there's a 1984 article about this, by James Anderson in Rockville that was trying to grow a variety of sugarcane in Maryland, in Rockville. This, as I talked about with sugarcane, it's essential to have that tropical environment, the sun, thinking of how can you locally produce a source of sugar. So some of those attempts were made. You have the sugar beet. The beets, you guys know the crop of beet. You can produce sugar from those as well. That was grown in Europe and in Maryland as well. There's this 1996 book about sugar beet in Maryland that I found for this talk. People thought about this. What was the role of sugar? Where did it? How did it appear? First would be, of course, this isn't really my topic for today, but rum is a product of sugar. There's a 2003 publication by Kearns and Cerrito talking about looking at court records in Annapolis. Between 1754 and 1761. Mid 18th century, rum coming into Annapolis was 81% of it was coming from the Caribbean, but 29% was coming from other American colonies as well. You could bring in the molasses and you could produce your own rum from that and other, as long as you ferment it properly. Molasses coming in, again, through Annapolis. 38% of that was coming from the Caribbean, but 42% was coming from other American colonies. 17% of the molasses was coming from England. So most of that molasses coming to Anne Arundel County was coming from other colonies. So again, it's like that, it's way more complex than that triangular trade model. It's the Atlantic economy where the intercolonial trade and things actually going to the metropole and then coming back. And then after the revolution, of course, there would be sugar refining that would take place in what's now the United States, where formerly Britain and France had reserved that right to refine the sugar, the nice white sugar that we're familiar with today. That was able to to grow in the U.S. as well. So there's some beverages, and some of you may be more familiar with this if I'm not originally from Maryland, but of course, rum as a frequently consumed source of alcohol produced from sugar. There are other beverages. There's this syllabub, where you would season milk, you would add sugar, white wine, and lemon juice, and whipped cream on top. That doesn't sound too appealing to me, but that was a popular drink at the time. There's a recipe I found in St. Mary's County referring to that. There's the term punch, and this is used for many things these days, but any type of a mix with, often it would be rum, usually some type of lime juice, or I saw one recipe of Maryland alcohol beverages, kumquat juice. I don't know too much about that, but you would mix sugar in there with, well, you know, if you just drink the rum, and if you drink, but that can be a little harsh, but if you put a little sugar in there, some syrup, that can kind of temper that flavor and make it more palatable. So you have various forms of punch that are developed. And maybe some of you are more familiar with these than I, there's a whole book about alcoholic drink beverages in Maryland, and many of them have sugar or syrup or other things that are added to them. You also see the used as a food, right? So of course the molasses, brown sugar, white sugar appear in many recipes, and I was just looking at a few of these. You don't really have too much sugar along with oysters or crab or locally available fish. I don't think sugar is a flavor that works with that at all. That's not appealing. But other things like cured meat, for example. So I was looking at a recipe for stuffed ham, of course, and that's St. Mary's County, is that around here too? Stuffed ham, or to cure the ham before you would cook it, that would require curing it with salt, 6 quarts of dark molasses, saltpeter, black and red pepper, and 2 pounds of brown sugar. So that sugar was essential to that. Many desserts, of course. I was looking at a book by Henry Bonner with a bunch of recipes for gingerbread, molasses, gingerbread, sugar, gingerbread, with, of course, sugar being a key ingredient to that. Smith Island cake, another example. All these desserts that are sugar, so you look at the recipes and it's like half a cup, a cup, 2 cups of white sugar, brown sugar. So that's developed as an essential part of any recipes. But there still are local, hopefully, things that are available as well. I mentioned the sugar beet earlier. That was explored as a potential crop to produce a locally source of sugar more cheaply than paying for the imported sugar from elsewhere. There's some literature about that in the 19th century, and there's some experiments going on with growing beets and using them as biofuel. In Eastern Shore, I was looking at some articles about that. You, of course, have the Domino Sugar Factory here in Baltimore. Now, I was looking a little bit more at the history of the Domino Sugar, and that's, of course, the brand that I have here. An apprentice to a London sugar refiner, William and his brother Frederick Havemeyer. They started out with a sugar refinery in New York City, and this would be after the revolution where you could now refine sugar in what was the United States. They had, went through various names, but the Domino Sugar name goes back to 1900. There's a big Domino factory in Brooklyn that's now, if I understand, is now abandoned. And then, of course, there's the one in the Inner Harbor of Baltimore. That was built in 1922, and that's a great location, right? The deep water port is there, you're close to roads and railways, and you can process your nice refined sugar in this factory right there. And I was reading about this in October 2017, there's some coverage of this newspaper. This factory got the largest shipment of raw sugar ever. So this is like I'm talking about, you produce the sugar, you get the muscovado, the darker version has molasses and other things in it. You refine it here, the largest shipment ever, 90 million pounds coming from Malawi, Mozambique, Swaziland, Zimbabwe, and Africa was brought to this factory. So still functioning and producing your sugar that you see in the supermarket or the hidden magnets and everything as well. And then there's also This is, I guess, part of the growth of craft brewing with beer and other distilleries that's happening throughout the United States. We're in a big boom period for that. You have the Lion Distilling in St. Michael's. I've tried some of this before. This is bringing your molasses from elsewhere and process it there. The Lion Distilling in St. Michael's was founded in 2012. The Blackwater is their Picaroon rum that's founded in 2008. They get their raw sugar, according to their website, from Brazil. They format it with a yeast from the island of Martinique and Caribbean, and they produce their rum as well. This is a longer history in the British colonies and the United States of making rum locally from sugar products. So, all right, I guess to kind of wrap things up then, and you know, hopefully this has been an experience for some of you to learn, you know, where sugar comes from, but to think about addiction and craving as well. You know, this flavor of sweetness and all of the so many foods, even the ones you aren't aware of, that are reliant upon the sugar, all the labor that goes into producing it, and how it's become sucrose in our cane sugar, an essential ingredient, and how difficult it is to kind of move away from that. You know, how could we imagine all of the foods and drinks that we have minus sugar? It certainly is very pleasurable. I won't deny that. Sugar tastes great. There's, all the Mr. Candy coming up and all the great desserts and so on that's out there. But I think what I've tried to show here today is how that that is an acquired taste, and you learn that from very young. I have a couple of small children at home, and I think already there's so much sugar that they eat. You know, I make them a pancake, make them a peanut butter and jelly sandwich. You look at the ingredients, and sugar it's just, it's everywhere. So we're learned that, we're conditioned from a very young age. And we then to understand where that comes from and how to think more broadly about it. It wasn't always a product that everybody had. First it was elites that were able to afford it, but since then it's just exploded into a very common product that whether we know or not, shaped so much of our lives. All right, so that is all I have for today. I am available for any questions that anyone may have. And thank you all for coming.
Questions, feel free to go ahead and ask Steve now, or as he says, he's going to be available for a little bit after the talk. And either way, thank you all for coming.
Did you say that somebody successfully grew sugar cane in Maryland?
As far as I understand from the article, there were some attempts. There was actually some competition from someone doing it in Virginia in the 1850s, but that didn't really work out too well. It didn't really happen. It requires these conditions of the sun and so on.
People used to grow citrus fruit. If you do it, you're in the greenhouse.
Okay, yeah, in the greenhouse, of course, yeah. And if you, I was looking at a few people, talking online, where you can grow sugar cane in other places. It's just like it doesn't come out so well. But it does happen to have that tropical.
More than a year, you said.
Yeah, and they would actually plant two crops. I mean, it takes a long time to plant it. So the first one would grow, they would cut it, and then the second, the sort of shoots of the cup would grow again. And that, yeah, that requires a lot of time.
Where does salt come from?
Sorry?
Where does salt come in?
Sorghum, yeah, that's not one that I know too much about, but that would be developed as another source of sweetness that would be able to be grown outside of a tropical environment. So I think it's like people trying to produce crops locally that made them less reliant on that more expensive sugar coming from outside. So sorghum, I don't know too much about that one. but I think that's along the same lines. How do we compete with this low, with the labor cost and the price of sugar coming in?
In colonial houses, when you see the sugar come in, it so often has the blue paper around it. And I wonder why blue and what's the historical connection to that?
I don't know if I've seen that before. That's on the sugar cone itself.
Indigo.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. That I haven't seen before. I mean, I know there's a repurposing of those sugar molds. People can use them for other things. But that's an interesting one. I know they put the clay on the top of the sugar mold. Maybe the manufacturer would market it in some way. That's interesting. Yeah.
Does sugar cane play the land as much as tobacco?
Yeah, I don't think quite as much as tobacco, but certainly it does. And that was always one of the problems in Brazil or Florida or the Caribbean where sugarcane was grown, is that you kind of had to keep moving out into new untouched areas. It's not quite as destructive as tobacco, in my understanding, but you know, that's why like new markets were always kind of opening up if you could secure the labor.
Did you say there was one harvest per year or multiple harvests?
The Ratoon one, which was the second harvest, I think it maybe was every 18 months or so, a couple harvests then. But there'd be the same planting season. I think that happened now. I think they would do that more in like what would be the spring, and then they would harvest like a year, 8 months later as the cane grew. Relying, of course, upon rain and not having a hurricane or infestation or something destroy it. But you know, that would be a lot of money. That would be kind of a lot of profit out there in the field. So there would be people that would stay up like a watchman to prevent children or anyone from taking the cane. There would be cane rats that would come and eat the cane. So then, at least in the Virgin Islands, then they brought in the mongoose to come in and kill the rats. But of course, the rats are out at night and the mongoose are in the day, so that didn't actually work. So the mongoose can kill the iguanas and the birds and all the other things. But it would be quite an investment. Then, of course, the infrastructure to build the factory, the aqueduct, to house the laborers, to grow this. And then, of course, you know, always wanted to expand.
How much sugar did Hawaii bring?
Did Hawaii?
Yeah, I know they had sugar there at one time.
Yeah, that I'm not sure about. It's like many commodities today where it kind of moves around between different periods. So I think Hawaii is a little bit later, I think maybe 19th, 20th century. Haven't really been exploited, but it's that same thing, looking for lower cost labor on lower exploited land to grow it on. So where's the majority of sugar produced today? I think in Africa there's a lot, still in Brazil. There are some places in the Caribbean where it's still done, but that's really kind of falling apart. So like in island of St. Kitts, they ended their sugar production. They had a railway that went around the entire island. The whole place was all set up for one factory. That ended in 2005, I think. So it's kind of declining there, but I think much of it and still it's grown in some places in Louisiana and places like that. As far as I know, it's not.
We have a question in from a YouTube viewer, and she is asking, when does brown sugar start to be produced?
I guess there's a couple different ways of, a couple varieties of brown sugar, right? There's the, I think I have this, on my opening slide, there's the turbinado sugar, the muscovado sugar, the thinner, more granular one that we know as brown sugar. So there's different types of that. But that would have been a product. It's not. Yeah, there we go. Different on the first slide there. Would have been produced. So that would have been made, I think, by the refiners very early on. You know, along with the white table sugar variety. But I think like that term, what we know as brown sugar, kind of but as I said, it obscures a lot of different varieties. It's more than just like brown. It's various levels of molasses or other impurities that are in there as well. But that would then be, again, at the same time as the refined white sugar.
Well, if there aren't any other questions, or did I see a hand almost go up?
Yes.
Would it be a part of this talk to discuss the tariff and protection of U.S. sugar growers?
Yeah, I mean, this has always been, throughout the whatever crop you're talking about, right? At least in the British colonial period, Britain would have forced its colonies to buy its own sugar, right? So if you were in the U.S. and came to the U.S., you had to buy British-produced sugar made in Barbados or Jamaica or wherever. So they would protect their own market, just like the French Islands. You had to have your own, your own French colonies, Saint-Domingue, Martinique, or wherever. So it's all about protecting your markets and ensuring a steady price. I'm more familiar with this with the Caribbean. There was a gradual decline of the sugar market by the 19th century, especially after the end of enslaved labor into the 20th century. It's just too expensive, and governments would get involved and try to prop it up. New companies would come in and purchase a factory and kind of build it up again. But that was one of the things that the sugar planters would always complain about, is that they didn't get the tariffs and support that they needed. So once those mercantile trade restrictions were removed, that's where you see more of the markets kind of moving around between Africa and Hawaii and a bunch of other places. Any type of commodity that's produced, you always run into that issue. Do you add a tariff to protect your crop and your producers and your consumers, or do you allow for free trade to commence? And that's, we're still dealing with that today.
There's one other flavor that is extremely popular, and that's salt. I wonder if you've done any, in what you've been doing, if you've considered the impact of salt versus sugar on consumption.
Yeah, that I don't know as much about. I mean, salt is pretty easy to produce. You just kind of have to, and I know these from the Caribbean Islands, you have your salt pond, you just let it evaporate, you put a bunch of sticks and other things there, and the salt just kind of crystallizes, and you collect it and ship it out from there. I don't think it requires quite the industrial manufacture the large amounts that like sugar would entail. But I guess it's another, salt is something that's essential to survive. There's people that will trade in places where salt isn't available locally. You have that craving. That's something that your body needs, whereas sugar doesn't. But like, I think salt's another one. We all consume probably way too much, again, if you have a dietary restriction, you're aware of that. But yeah, salt's a little different story. I'm not too familiar with that. That's where the addiction problem comes in, because you have that craving for salt, and that's because your body needs it, right? But we also have that craving for sugar and other foods. Are we really addicted to it? It would be hard to remove it, but it's just kind of infiltrated everything that we eat and drink. So I hope that answers that. I'm sorry, I don't know too much about salt.
If you could go to a coffee house or a tavern in the colonial times, how was the sugar put on the table? Or how would you put in your coffee?
I'm not sure too much about it, but I think it would just be in any small ceramic vessel that you would see as a receptacle either on the table or for the server to use. There would be sugar bowls and things like that, other ways of storing them. I don't know how well that would show up in a inventory or an archaeological collection to know what specifically is used for sugar, but I don't think I'm aware. Maybe there's like a sugar bowl you have at home now, but I don't know if they had that specifically. That's a good question as well.
And in the William Brown house in the kitchen, they have a loaf of sugar and they have a special spoon that they sliced it with.
Yeah.
So it was a sugar loaf.
Yeah, that's in the sugar mold, that cone-shaped thing. Mm-hmm. So it depends, I guess, what stage of the, you know, would you buy an entire loaf for yourself or your establishment, so you might need a container for that, or are you, you know, just in your own house, do you need a smaller amount, and would it be worth it to buy an entire loaf and protect it from the hands and kids and everybody?
If there aren't any more questions, please join me in giving Steve another round of applause.